हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक. मायसेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर करंट अफेयर्स. सो दीज क्लासेस आर मेंट फॉर दोज स्टूडेंट्स हु आर बेसिकली प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द गवर्नमेंट एग्जामिनेशंस एंड दीज एग्जामिनेशंस रिक्वायर द करंट अफेयर्स इन द एग्जामिनेशन. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू कवर द करंट अफेयर्स फॉर 16th of January 2021 एंड आई एम बेसिकली रेफरिंग द टू नेशनल न्यूज़पेपर्स द हिंदू एंड इंडियन एक्सप्रेस. द हिंदू एंड इंडियन एक्सप्रेस यू कैन ऑल्सो रेफर बोथ ऑफ दीज न्यूज पेपर्स. बोथ ऑफ दीज न्यूज पेपर्स आर इक्वली गुड, राइट? और यू कैन रेफर एनी ऑफ दीज न्यूज पेपर्स ऑल्सो. ऑल राइट, सो लेट्स बिगिन विद द करंट अफेयर्स. ऑल राइट, सो द फर्स्ट न्यूज इज रिलेटेड टू द गावी गंगादेश्वरा टेम्पल. दिस गावी गंगादेश्वरा टेम्पल इज लोकेटेड in Gavipuram, right, in Bangalore, Karnataka, right, first of all right, so it is located in the Bangalore, Karnataka. Now, why this temple in the news? Because there is, you know, the religious significance attached with the temple, the religious significance in terms of the people or the devotees. Basically, every year they used to come to worship for this Gavi Gangadeshwara temple, and they used to come and they used to worship for the Shivalinga, right? Here the people have, you know, or this temple has certain special features. Like, for example, only in Makar Sankranti, right, or in some part of the year, for one year the sunrays basically directly falls on Shivalinga, right? So it is the auspicious, right, the time for the devotees to look into the sun sign which is falls directly on the Shivalinga for 1 hour during Makar Sankranti, right? But what happens this year is during Makar Sankranti the rays did not fall, right, because they were clouding in the city, and because of that, in the first time in the 50 years the sun rays did not fall on the idol on Makar, on the idol of the Lord Shiva, or, you know, the Shivalinga. So that is the reason this temple is in the news. All right, so as I told you that Gavi Gangadeshwara temple is also known as Gavipuram cave temple. It is located in the Gavipuram in the Bangalore, Karnataka, and it is an example of the rock cut architecture, right? And this is dedicated to Shiva or Lord Shiva, and which is cut into the monolithic stone, and which is basically used, right, or which is basically having the tremendous significance for, you know, for the worshippers or for the devotees who basically flock during Makar Sankranti. All right, so it is located in the Bangalore, Karnataka. All right, and it is built in the 16th century by, you know, the founder of the Bangalore city was the Kempe Gowda I. The Kempe Gowda I, who was the founder, so it was constructed by Kempe Gowda I in 16th century. And this temple is famous, right, for is the mysterious, you know, stone disc in the forecourt, right, which allow, you know, the sun to sign, or which allow the sun signs to reach to the shrine in the certain time of the year, or like in the certain time of the year. So which is also having the tremendous significance in that respect. All right, and lakhs of the devotees throughout the India basically flock or gathered for this during the Makar Sankranti, roughly in middle January every year, right? And it is a special day when the sun rays directly falls on the Shivalinga, right, for 1 year or for 1 hour. And when as it passes between the horns of the Nandi, so Nandi is basically also, you know, the small statue of the Nandi is also there, right, adjacent to Shivalinga. All right, so this is a temple which is basically in the news due to the sun rays not falls in the first time in the 50 years, right, on the Shivalinga. All right, and it is basically the temple which is basically famous for this. All right, next, India Meteorological Department, IMD. So it is basically in the news because the IMD celebrated 146th foundation day on the 15th January 2021. So 146th day or 146th foundation day was celebrated, right? So on this occasion, the Union Minister for the Science and Technology, who is Dr. Harshvardhan, inaugurated, right, two weather Dopplers or two Doppler weather radars. These radars would be, you know, stationed at Mukteshwar first in Uttarakhand and in the Kufri in the Himachal Pradesh. All right. So these two Doppler radars are set up, right, or inaugurated basically in these two places. One is at Uttarakhand, second is at Himachal Pradesh. All right. And it also inaugurated the multi-mission meteorological data, right, receiving and the processing system, right, in the IMD with collaboration of ISRO. So it is basically also known as MMDRPS, right, which is also known as the multi-mission meteorological data receiving and the processing center for better data processing, for better forecasting of the weathering data, right. And it is officially launched, right, or the Union Minister of Science and Technology also officially launched the online web portal for IMD General Mausam, right. So here the online web portal for IMD General Mausam have been launched. It is launched in the collaboration of CSIR NISCAR, and it is basically released in a special issue of Mausam, right, on the tropical cyclone, right. So a special issue on the Mausam have been launched, have been also issued, released, right, which is based on the tropical cyclone, and it is the online web portal for IMD General Mausam. All right, fine. Next, driverless metro car. So this was in the news because Raksha Mantri or the Defense Minister basically unveiled the India's first indigenously designed and the developed driverless metro car. All right. So it is the metro train, right, or the metro car. It is basically, you know, indigenously built, right, indigenously designed and indigenously developed, right. So here, you know, the Defense Minister basically unveiled the state of art driverless metro car for Mumbai Metropolitan Region Development Authority, or which is also known as MMRDA, right. So he unveiled the state of art driverless metro car for MMRDA, right. It will be used for the Mumbai Metropolitan Regional Development Authority, all right. And it is basically unveiled at the function which is held at the BEML Bangalore complex, right. So BEML basically is the, you know, this basically manufacturing, right, the driverless metro car, all right. So it is basically indigenously designed and developed, the state of art driverless metro car trains, which is basically manufactured at BEML Bangalore complex, all right. And you know, this Mumbai Metropolitan Regional Development Authority project has 63% indigenous content. So the indigenous content has 63%, and it will enhance to 75% in the next 2 to 3 years. All right. So in the next 2 to 3 years, it will be enhanced to 75%. All right. So the indigenous content will increase, and the capability for the BEML Bangalore complex also will increase in this fashion. All right. And Rajnath Singh also virtually launched the aerospace assembly hangar, all right, which is also situated in the BEML complex in the Bengaluru, right. It will be used for, you know, for aerospace type of, you know, the infrastructure. And also it also unveiled the indigenously manufactured the Tetra cabin by BEML. So all these things have been done in the BEML complex, or BEML, you know, Bengaluru complex, right. And it is in the news because the Defense Minister has unveiled the indigenously designed and developed the first driverless metro car in, you know, in the Bangalore, in the complex of BEML. All right. So it is a picture where you can see, you know, you can see basically Rajnath Singh ji, who is also the Defense Minister, and who basically, you know, unveiled the India's first indigenously, you know, developed and designed, you know, the driverless metro car. All right. So next is basically Prarambh. So it is basically, you know, it is basically a summit, right? So this summit is totally, I mean, the full name is for this, the Prarambh Startup India International Summit. All right. So it is basically an international summit, right? And it is basically relevant to the startups, which is basically starting in India. All right. So here, the Minister of Commerce and the Industry, Piyush Goyal basically inaugurated the Prarambh, which is also known as the Startup India International Summit. All right. And it is basically the 2-day Prarambh Startup India, right, International Summit, which already began in the New Delhi, right? And the participants basically in this summit is basically, you know, the members of the BIMSTEC, or Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectoral Technical and the Economic Cooperation. All right. So here the basically members belongs to the BIMSTEC, all right, have participated in this startup, you know, or in this Startup India International Summit, right? And you know, by this, you know, the number of countries also increased, right, for this summit. You can see here the number of countries basically participated, over 25 countries, and more than 200 global speakers are also participated in this summit, all right? And it is the largest Startup India International Summit organized by the Government of India ever. And right, this, you know, this was first launched in 2016. Since then, it was the largest Startup India International Summit, all right? And as it is organized by the Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, which is under the Ministry of Commerce and the Industry, right? So it is ultimately, you can say, it is organized by the Ministry of Commerce and the Industry, all right? And why this, you know, the startup, you know, Startup India International Conference was inaugurated, or why it is started? It is started because in the fourth BIMSTEC Summit, which was held basically in the Kathmandu in August 2018. So here, because of this fourth BIMSTEC Summit, which was held in Kathmandu, right? Basically, you know, the announcement was made by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, right? Regarding this Startup India International Summit. So because of that, right, you know, this all process was started, all right? And the summit was basically also demonstration of neighborhood first policy, which is also the NDA's policy for, you know, for giving, you know, the upper hand to the neighborhood, or to give, you know, preferences or the priority to the neighborhood in this respect, all right? And you can see the countries which is participating. So here the BIMSTEC of Bay of Bengal, you know, right, Bay of Bengal initiative for the multi-sectoral technical and the economic cooperation. So these countries have been incorporated or have been participated, right? So here you can see the Nepal, India, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and the Thailand. So it is the map which shows the number of countries which participated, right? So around 25 such countries basically participated, right, in this process, all right? And you know, it is also, you know, one of the important announcement for, you know, for the startups, for their, you know, the early startup, as well as for their you know, the sustainable development perspective. All right, let's understand the next news, that is Kevadia railway station. So Kevadia railway station is famous, I mean, it has become famous because of, you know, the Statue of Unity, which was basically revealed by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So here nearby the Statue of, you know, the Unity, the nearest station is basically the Kevadia, right? So here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, right, will basically flag off 8 special trains. These 8 trains basically will be connecting, right, the Kevadia railway station, right, on the 17th of January 2021 from the different parts of, or from the different parts of the country, all right? The ultimate aim of starting or the flagging of these trains is basically, right, for, you know, for better connectivity with the Kevadia to the rest of the country, all right? And this train will facilitate the seamless connectivity, right, to the Statue of Unity, all right? So it will basically facilitate, you know, the seamless connectivity with the Statue of the Unity, which is also located on the banks of the Narmada River in basically in the Kevadia in the Gujarat, all right? And you know, the Prime Minister will also inaugurate, you know, some sort of a railway line which was also constructed, right? So the railway line which was constructed was the Daboi Chandod gauge converted broad gauge railway line. So here previously the lane was gauge, now it is converted to broad gauge, right? So Prime Minister Narendra Modi would be, you know, inaugurating, you know, this line also. And here another set of line, that is Chandod Kevadia new broad gauge railway line, right? And also the newly electrified Pratapnagar Kevadia section, and also the new station building of Daboi, Chandod and Kevadia will be, you know, inaugurated by Narendra Modi, all right? And you must also understand that Kevadia is India's first railway station which has, you know, the green building certification with it, right? So it is a green building certification, which means it is not, you know, it is, you know, green building, that means it's the requirement for the energy is basically generated within, right, you know, within the station itself, and such energy does not require the, you know, adverse impact on the environment, all right? So which is basically the first railway station with green building certification, which is also known as Kevadia station. All right. So it is basically the Statue of Unity of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, which is located in nearby Kevadia. All right. Then MIL Rail. All right. So here it is in the news because why this MIL Rail? So MIL Rail is nothing but, you must understand, it is an extension of Traffic Directorate of Ministry of Railways, right? So here, you know, the extension of Traffic Directorate of the Ministry of Railways, which is basically headed by the Executive Director level officer, right? Which comes under, or which is basically, level officer with the office at Indian Army Headquarters. So it is basically an extension of Traffic Directorate, which is basically used, right, for armed forces, right, for its various operations, right? So it is basically, taking care of such, the transportation need, right, for the Indian Army, right, during such pandemic or during also various operations. So here, the news related to MIL Rail is the Amrish Kumar Chaudhary, who is basically also the chief, who is also basically, the chief controller in the MIL Rail. All right. So here, the Amrish Kumar Chaudhary basically awarded the prestigious Chief of the Army Staff Commendation, right? So here, the Chief of Army Staff Commendation was awarded to the Amrish Kumar Chaudhary for his contribution towards the armed forces, right? Which has also contributed during the critical period of COVID-19 pandemic, right? For transporting, the men and the materials, as well as for various critical operations for the Indian Armed Forces, all right? So as I told you that it is an extension of the Traffic Directorate of Ministry of Railways and, which is headed by the Executive Director, all right? And the ultimate, objective of this MIL Rail is basically for overall coordination, for strategic planning, and for execution of railway logistic support to the defense forces, all right? So it is basically responsible for the overall coordination with the Indian Railways, for strategic planning, right? For execution of, the railways logistic support to the armed forces during peace and emergency situations, all right? So during peace and emergency situations, the railways or the strategic arm of the Indian Railways, which is also, MIL Rail, is responsible for the strategic planning and execution of railway logistic support to the Indian Army, all right, or to the defense forces. Now, the MIL Rail, it works always with a close coordination with Ministry of Defense, right? Because ultimately, the men and materials for the Ministry of Defense or for the armed forces will be transferred by this MIL Rail, all right? So definitely the close coordination is needed with the Ministry of Defense, all right? And so that, the railways meet its all requirements, right, for the Indian Armed Forces, all right? And there is separate control room also, which manage all such railway operations, which basically, the transport, all sort of men and materials to the armed forces, to the, length and breadth of our country. So it is basically headed by the chief controller, right? All right. So it is basically a train which is basically loaded with men and materials for the Indian Armed Forces. All right. Next, the Dhara Shiv Caves. All right. So again, the Maharashtra CM, who is also, the Thackeray, basically referred, right? Osmanabad is basically a district in the Maharashtra as the Dhara Shiv. All right. So he was also in the controversy because he named, or he was also proposing, the Aurangabad, which is also a district in the Maharashtra, as Sambhajinagar, right? As the Sambhajinagar, which is also covered, right, in the news analysis. So here, the Aurangabad is, according to, the Maharashtra CM, it should be renamed as Sambhajinagar. In the similar fashion, the Osmanabad, right, will be named as, because he is referring to Osmanabad as a Dhara Shiv, right? Dhara Shiv is basically, the caves which are located over there, all right? So basically, Osmanabad is named after the last ruler of Hyderabad, which is also known as Mir Osman Ali Khan, right? Mir Osman Ali Khan, right? So it is basically, he was the last ruler of the Hyderabad, and Dhara Shiv is basically, having some sort of relevance with the caves or the 6th century, built caves, which is also located nearby city, around 6 to 7 kilometers from the city. All right. So it is also reference to those caves which was built during 6th century. All right. So as I told you, Dharashiv is basically caves which is having around 7 caves. All right. And it is located around 8 kilometers away from the city or from the main city called Osmanabad. Right. It is basically located, or these caves are basically located in the Balaghat Mountains in the Maharashtra. So it is located in the Balaghat Mountains in the Maharashtra. All right. And, the Dharashiv caves also declared as a protected area by the government of Maharashtra. All right. And you must understand that it is basically, built around 5th to 7th century. In our 5th to 7th century, right, AD, definitely. And, it is, in the debate, right, or in the controversy, whether the caves belongs to the Buddhist or Jain. So, right, whether they are the Buddhist creations or whether they are Jain creation. So, it is basically on the debate. All right. And it is widely believed that originally the caves belongs to the Buddhism, or they basically originally the Buddhist used to have these caves or used to use these caves. Right. But some of these caves basically later converted to the, Jain caves where, the Jain deities have been set up. All right. So, but originally these caves belongs to the Buddhism. All right. So it is the caves, which is also, you can see these caves. So there are 7 caves, right, which is located around 8 kilometers away from the Osmanabad. All right. Next, the Dizukau Valley. The Dizukau Valley. So first of all, you must understand it is in the news because, because the Dizukau Valley, first of all, you must understand it is basically in the Manipur Nagaland border, right? So here what happens is in the Dizukau Valley, right, a wildfire was started, or wildfire was erupted. Now it was extinguished, or it was doused, right, after 2 weeks. So it has caused so much, destruction, right, to the adjacent area, right? So here let's understand about the Dizukau Valley. The Dizukau Valley is basically located on the borders of the state of Nagaland and the Manipur. All right. So it is located on the borders of Nagaland and the Manipur, which has also caused destruction to Nagaland and the Manipur. And it is situated at the altitude of 2,452 meters above mean sea level. And it is basically famous for the flowers. Okay. So wide range of the flowers is basically there in every season. And, the most famous, right, is the Dizukau lily, which is also famous, which is widely cultivated, or which is widely grown in this, Dizukau Valley, and which is also found in this valley. So it is in the news because the Dizukau Valley was on the fire, and this fire was, right, somehow controlled after 2 weeks, and it has caused so much destruction to the nearby ecology. All right. So it is basically the Dizukau Valley where the fire raged and which has caused the tremendous, impact on the adjacent regions. All right. Next, the publication of notice of marriage not mandatory. So here what is happening is that there is one act which is also known as Special Marriage Act, right? So under the Special Marriage Act, the person can become married, or person can get married, right? So what is there, there are certain sections in the Special Marriage Act which provide that, under the Special Marriage Act, there should be a publication of the notice of the intended marriage, right? So the Allahabad High Court basically ruled that the provision of the publication of the notice of the intended marriage, right, is not mandatory. So that means it is not mandatory, right, to publish. It is not mandatory to publish the notice of intended marriage, right, which is not mandatory according to the interpretation done by the Allahabad High Court. And, the court basically further said that the publication, such publication mandatory would invade, right, if you are publicating certain notice or regarding the marriage, right, it is basically invading, or it is impacting the fundamental rights of the couple, or it is invading the liberty and the privacy of the couple, right? So it is basically, the freedom to choose marriage, right? The freedom to choose marriage, or freedom to choose the life partner, right? It is basically, without interferences from the state or the non-state actors, right? So it depends on the person concerned, right? Rather than on, you know, on dependent on the state or non-state actors. All right. So here you must understand that the freedom to choose life partner or to choose for the marriage, right, without interfering from either from the state or non-state actors, is the person's choice. All right, is a fundamental right of the person. Right, if any such publication impact, you know, obviously the liberty and the privacy of the concerned person. So here, some of the sections of the Special Marriage Act 1954, you can see that, right, under section 5 of the Special Marriage Act will say that it shall be optional for the parties to intended marriage to make request to writing to the marriage officer to publish or not to publish such a notice under section 6, right, and follow the procedure. So here, under section 5 of the Special Marriage Act, right, it is not compulsory, but it is an optional. It is not compulsory, but it is an optional for the parties, right, to make a request, right, in the writing. So parties can make a request on the writing that to marriage officer, who is basically, you know, solemnizing the marriage, all right, that he did not want to publish this information, right, as a public information, as a notice, right. So under section 6, they can basically request, or they can basically request in the writing to the marriage officer that they did not want, or they do not want to publish our marriage in the public, all right. And but provided they should follow the procedure of the objections as prescribed under Act, right. All right. So it is not necessary for this, all right. And you know, you must understand, court also further elaborated that if the parties did not make any request, right, the officer shall not publish any such notice, right. So here you must understand, if the party is not making any such request, it does already mean, or it is automatically, or it is understood that the officer or the marriage officer shall not publish any notice or any objection to the intended marriage, all right, and which is proceeding with the solemnization of the marriage, right? And it should proceed the solemnization of the marriage. It should not entertain any objection. It should not publish any notice, right? If the parties also do not make any request for it, right? So it is irrelevant whether the parties is, see, if the party is making you to request to do something, then you publish, because it is an optional. Unnecessarily you should not publish for this, right? So here you must understand that it should not publish unnecessarily, right, the information, all right. So under section 5, it is optional. It is not dependent on, you know, the will of the marriage officer whether to publish or not, but it is according to section 5 of the act, right? If the parties give in the writing, then only it should publish. Otherwise, it should not publish. Even if the party do not make a request, the officer, right, if the party do not make a request, the officer All right, so it is the picture for the newly married couple. All right, next, Ved Mehta. So first of all, you must understand the Indian-American author Ved Mehta, who is basically recently died, right? Who was basically a blind person, and he was basically widely known as the 20th century writer. And who is basically responsible for the introducing of the American readers to India. All right, so he is basically, you know, the widely known actor who is basically, you know, known for introducing the American readers in India. He was recently died in the US, right, with the complications from the Parkinson's disease. All right. So he is basically the Ved Prakash Mehta, who is basically born in 1934 and he died in 2021. And he was basically the Indian American or Indian born writer. And he was mainly working in the US. All right. So in the childhood time, he lost his eyes, right, at the age of 3 from meningitis. Right, but he did not, you know, stop here, right? So he challenged to himself, and he stopped him from showcasing its literally process of the word. All right, and here you must understand he is basically known for his 12-volume memoir, right, which is mainly focusing on the troubled modern history of India, right? And his early struggle with the blindness, right? So he's mainly writing about the modern India or the modern history of India and his early blindness, all right? And you must also understand that he was publishing, you know, installment from, you know, his own autobiography is publishing from 1972 to 2004, right? And you must also understand the Mehta bought 24 such books, all right? The 24 such books, and such books are basically, you know, having, you know, some sort of a volumes regarding, you know, for example, certain books are also, you know, the walking the Indian streets 1960, the portrait of India 1970, the Mahatma Gandhi and his apostles 1977, as well as the exploration related to philosophy, theology and the linguistics. Basically, he bought such books, all right. And he wrote for the New Yorkers for many times. So he was known for writing extensively. He wrote, you know, the 12 volume memoir, right, regarding this. And all right. And he wrote, you know, his biography is already published in the installment from 1972 to 2004. And he was basically Ved Prakash already. All right. So thank you very much for this news. Thank you. Thank you very much.